So we're talking about altruism, people being nice to other people, people doing things for other people and not expecting anything out of it. Some might contend that altruism has so many internal rewards that people do it more for their own benefit than that of others. That's an interesting way to look at it. Thus, they contend that altruism is a form of egoism where the real benefit is that of the giving individual. So if you're one of those individuals that needs things, you're actually doing a favor to all these people that are giving you something because they get so much more out of it than you. However, of course, Daniel Batson sees altruism as working both as self-serving and selfless act. This is Daniel Batson. Batson referred to our focus on the sufferer's distress as empathy, genuine sympathy and compassion for the other individual. So we feel compassion for those select individuals that we are trying to help. Such empathy comes naturally. Other animals are empathic. If you've ever been around a dog, when one dog was injured, the other dog will come over and lick their wounds. They will protect the dog. They will comfort them as best they can. They will show distress at another's emotional response. Babies, this is really irritating. Of course, the nurses hated me because my job was to go in and draw blood from the babies. It was fun. So you would go in, you'd stick one baby, and you know, I'm really good at it. So sometimes the babies didn't even cry. But as soon as that first baby cried, they all started crying. It was really like they're all going, "Don't stick me!"
Did you know that for depressing, when they prick the finger?
Yeah.
My sister is learning how to do that. And she said recently, the little babies, they don't cry when she does that.
If you do it fast enough, they don't even feel it.
And then the older ones, they're the ones that tend to cry.
Of course they do, because they think it's going to hurt. Yeah. But half the time, they can't even feel it. Empathy produces helping even toward members of rival groups. With their empathy aroused, people will help even when they believe no one will know about their helping. So Batson may be right. They don't just do it for themselves. They're doing it for themselves, yes, but they're not doing it for any external rewards. With their empathy aroused, people will violate their own standards of fairness and justice by giving the person favored treatment. And that's really kind of interesting. Sometimes people will help others when there is no self-interest involved, but because society prescribes the helping behavior as a norm. There are two social norms that have to do with altruism. One is the reciprocity norm. These are expectations that if you help a person, they will help you and not hurt you. So if you help somebody, then they won't kill you. So we do it to create allies. The other is social responsibility norms. These are expectations that people will help those dependent upon them. So we help our children, we help anybody that needs help. And that's the social responsibility norm. Evolutionary psychology purports that animals are driven to maximize their survival, the survival of their own genes. It's really kind of fascinating. So you're more likely to help somebody who is in your genetic pool. Thus, an individual is more likely to put their children's welfare ahead of their own, though children are less likely to sacrifice themselves for their parents. And this is usually the way it works. Usually parents give to their children, and children don't give to their parents. So if a child has lots of money, and they still don't give it to their parents. But parents will spend their last penny to buy, you know, kicks for some kid, one of their kids. If they need Air Jordans, then they buy them Air Jordans.
My
brother. Do you have a brother that wears Jordans?
My whole family on my dad's side likes to wear Jordans.
Oh my gosh.
I don't know. I stopped wearing them when I was
Did you explain to them that Jordan stopped playing basketball like in 1995?
They're huge Jordan fans.
Oh, jeez. He's an old man. He's got, what, $1.8 billion or something. This kin favoritism is referred to as kin selection, favoritism for those who share our genes. Now, the interesting thing about that is you guys have this really interesting clan system where there are people, members of your clan don't really share your genes. And if they do, it's way, way back. We're talking about thousands of individuals in your clan. And potentially they don't really share your genes. This favoritism may be prevalent with people who aren't actually relatives, but who look similar to us. And that, of course, that's what we're talking about when we're talking about your clan system. Evolutionary psychologists also believe that we may help others because we expect others to return the favor, and of course this is known as reciprocity. While reciprocity is unlikely to work in large and personal urban areas, it does tend to work in small isolated groups, like here on the reservation. Maybe it's out there, I just don't see it. Reciprocity means if you help me fix my car, I'll help you move your furniture into your house. That's reciprocity. People in small groups feel closer to the others in the groups and will often sacrifice for them with the understanding that when fortunes are reversed, reciprocity will happen. So the idea is that I help you and maybe in the future you help me do something, murder my wife or whatever. I'm just kidding. Large and impersonal sometimes has the opposite effect, of course. And now we're going to talk about some of the horrors that we have seen in the world. This is Kitty Genovese. 1964, Kitty Genovese was attacked by a knife-wielding rapist in front of her own apartment house in Queens. For 35 minutes, she fought off her rapist while screaming in terror in the middle of the street. 38 of her neighbors were aroused and observed the attack from the safety of their homes. None helped, none even called the police. Kitty Genovese was raped and died from her wounds. He attacked her for 35 minutes. But nobody did anything, even though everybody was looking out their window and they watched. Like it was a television show.
Wasn't there like a study done on this too, when they had a homeless man like somewhere in New York City? So they had him sitting out there for like 30 minutes, and they had someone from their own team come over, start helping him, and then more people started to jump in.
Yeah, we're going to talk about that. But not that exact experiment. Andrew Mormill was attacked on a crowded subway car. He was knifed in the stomach. I don't know if you've people getting stabbed in the stomach. His attackers left the car at the next stop. 11 riders watched the man bleed to death as they rode home. Didn't even try to help. They just let him bleed to death. As much fun as that is. 18-year-old switchboard operator was sexually assaulted while working alone. She escaped out in the street, naked and bleeding, with her attacker in pursuit. 40 pedestrians watched as the attacker tried to pull her back inside. She's naked, she's bleeding, and nobody did anything. Luckily, two policemen happened by and they stopped the assault. We see naked bleeding people all the time. It doesn't really, it's crazy. Eleanor Bradley tripped and broke her leg in a crowded street. Dazed and in pain, she pleaded for help for 40 minutes. Shoppers parted and flowed around her. Nobody did jack. A cab driver finally helped her to a doctor. She's laying on the sidewalk, and everybody just kind of walked around her like she wasn't there. In June of 2000, a parade that wound past Central Park took a turn for the macabre when groups of drunk men began tearing the clothes off of and fondling female parade watchers. Ann Payton was forced to negotiate her way home with her underwear torn away. Police ignored the problem and no calls from cell phones were received, despite the thousands who watched the attacks. Thousands. They thought it was funny. The Kitty Genovese rape and murder was a wake-up call for most social psychologists. This is in 1954. Wasn't it? Was it 1954? It was 1958. 1964. Before that, we weren't sure. We'd never seen anything like this before. We knew what the Nazis did during World War II, but this was the United States, this was us, and we didn't do anything. And we've seen case after case after case after case of individuals who just don't help. They just watch people die. We have cases of individuals who were threatening to jump off of a building, and the larger the crowd down below, the more they were chanting, jump, 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 jump. Isn't that horrible? That could never happen on the reservation. You guys love each other too much. I'm kidding.
Okay. Only when something bad happens.
And nobody helps. Unwilling to accept the callousness of Kitty's neighbors, psychologists began researching to discover how and why such egregious crimes can be watched and allowed to continue with no one lifting a finger to help. And what they discovered was the bystander effect. Researchers discovered that people in large groups are less observant than people in small groups. Research done with smoke pouring from an air vent demonstrated that people in large groups took 4 times as long to see the smoke. This is them seeing their own danger, danger that might potentially injure them. But it took them 4 times as long if they were in a large group. They just ignored it. Like the people around them were far more important than their own safety. Thus, the people in the crowd partying around Eleanor Bradley may not have even noticed Eleanor laying there until after they passed. With advance notice in a less crowded sidewalk, the individual may have been more likely to see Eleanor and evaluate her need. Once upon a time, I was working at another institution. I saw a situation that looked dangerous. I thought it was dangerous. The students were all starting to come in. It was early in the morning. I saw a broken guitar. Somebody had taken an electric guitar and smashed it. And right beside it was a broken vase. And I thought, well, this isn't good. Who breaks a guitar and just leaves it sitting there? So I went in and I told security, and of course security starts arguing with me. No, I'm sure everything's fine, don't worry. We never have any incidents here. I said, no, I think something's going on. People just don't do that kind of stuff. Mm-hmm. And the more people that came in, the more they argued with me. In the beginning, they at least listened to what I had to say. But the more students that came in, the more they were more involved with keeping the students from walking into the walls or something, whatever. And so what eventually happened was the head of security was a friend of mine. We're both military people. And because he knew that I was a psychologist and he knew that I noticed things, he decided that he was going to see if he could figure out what was going on. So they started, they called it Code Yellow, which had to do with all the security personnel going out and checking everywhere. Well, what happened was they found up on the 6th floor, there's nobody ever went to the 6th floor. You weren't supposed to be on the 6th floor. Up on the 6th floor, this guy had attempted suicide. And he's the one that broke his guitar. This guy used to sit in the quad, you know, in the open area around all the buildings, and play his guitar, his electric guitar, without it plugged in. So you've heard what electric guitars just plunk, 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 plunk. Anyway, he used to do that all the time. I never saw him, but when I saw his broken guitar, I knew something was wrong. Anyway, he tried to commit suicide. Actually, he succeeded. He wasn't dead yet. Unfortunately, when he took pills, and when he collapsed with his head down the stairs. So all the drugs kind of went into his head. Anyway, he died, committed suicide. But nobody, for the longest time, well, it wasn't that long. It was only 4 or 5 minutes, but I couldn't convince them that they needed to do something about it. And they were just trying to tell me that everything was fine. I was at Ashford from 2011 to 2015. So it was 2013. Anyway, he died. And he was from a town right next door, which was a little weird. So he's from a small town. All the people from that small town knew him, and they all thought he was weird. Okay. The larger the group of people, the more likely that an individual will accept the implied definition of an event of the group. If everyone else in the group seems unconcerned, an individual is less likely to interpret a situation as negative. And that's exactly what I was dealing with. I was dealing with everybody. They were security personnel, and that was their job, was to keep people from getting excited. So that's what they tried to do. But unfortunately, of course, the kid died because they didn't get excited. This is partially due to pluralistic ignorance, the mistaken interpretation that others are feeling what we are due to our illusion of transparency, the overestimation of others' ability to read our internal states. So as we're walking down as you're walking on the sidewalk, not here of course, in Gallup or in Albuquerque, you're walking down the sidewalk, when you look at somebody, do you know what they're thinking? Probably not. And that is, of course, the solution of transparency. Everybody knows what I feel. Everybody knows what I'm feeling. And the reality is that only psychologists can read people's minds. And we only think that we can read people's minds. We really can. And of course,
I think people can read minds to some extent in certain situations.
Well, you look at somebody's facial expression. Usually, you can figure out what's going on.
When I pull up behind someone, they know I want to pass and they speed up.
That's only here on the reservation. I told you about the guy that's going 40 miles an hour, pulled up behind him, and all of a sudden he's going 50, then he's going 55, and he slowed down when we came to a place where I could actually not pass him. So he
kept
slowing
down. Happened to me this morning.
What a bunch of jackasses. I assumed that they were white people. No, they weren't. Latin and Rodin, older individuals drive like that from time to time. I know I'm old, but I don't drive like that. I drive really fast. I have a little red car, so I'm allowed to drive fast. I think. Latin and Rodin staged an experiment around a woman in distress. 70% of the individuals, when alone, responded to the woman's obvious distress. 40% of the pairs responded to the woman's distress. In other words, if a man was with if two men were together, or a man was with a woman, or two women were together, 40% of the time they responded to her distress. Of the 60% who didn't respond, most interpreted the situation as a non-emergency. As the number of people witnessing the emergency increased, the less likely anyone would render assistance. So the more people that were there, the less likely that they were to render assistance. It gets better. we'll get there in just a second. This is all the bystander effect. Assuming responsibility, not only are people more likely to misinterpret an actor's actions while in a group, but they are also more likely to misinterpret the willingness of other bystanders to help. And this is the problem. If you're in a group, who's the one that's supposed to help? The biggest one? The most male? The most masculine one? Who's supposed to help? And eventually, of course, nobody helps. Because I'm assuming that guy's going to help, and that guy's not going to help because he thinks that my group should help instead of him. He's all by himself, and there's two of us. And we can rationalize this all day long, and eventually, of course, nobody helps. It seems that the more people who witness a situation, the more likely each is to assume that someone else will take responsibility for the situation. This is a diffused responsibility for the action. It's diffused responsibility, and nobody does jack. Jack? Studies in large cities and more rural settings show that the fewer the people involved, the more likely the people will intervene. So if I saw somebody floating down the river and they looked like they were drowning, and I was by myself, I'd be more likely to help than if I were with 15 or 16 people. The reality is I can't swim, so it's really stupid for me to do anything anywhere close to that damn water, because I go right to the bottom. Youssef and Corte, looking at New Yorkers' failure to, time and time again, to respond to the aid of others. Other individuals refers to the atmosphere in large municipalities as sensory overload and compassion fatigue. And if you just try to get them to say hello, just try to get them to do anything. People in Denver, people in Phoenix, people in Albuquerque, people in, especially New York, those are the meanest sons of bitches I've ever been. Grouchy too. Boston, they won't help you. They'll laugh at you, but they won't help you. You get
it. I was just wondering about this bystander effect. I know, like, a lot of people, when I see that they don't want to help in the situation, I hear them verbalize it. The person got himself into that situation. Why should I risk
exactly. it? I don't want to get involved.
Myself.
Sure.
If that person put himself in that situation.
Exactly. Exactly. Now, here's the kicker. I didn't realize that so few people in the United States have been in the military. It's like 1% of the population are in the military. Not very many. But military people are trained to respond, aren't we? Yeah. We see something happening, we respond. We are trained to go to the problem rather than away from the problem. And of course, but we were trained. So people that weren't in the military, they don't think in the same direction. They think in the opposite direction that we do. So we're trained to respond, like first responders.
They're conditioned.
Yeah, we're conditioned. Well, it is a conditioning process, of course. But city people, you know, nobody wants to get involved. And I don't know what your training was, but if you had any city people in your military unit, they were the last people to do anything, always. if you needed a job done and you guys lined up to pick something up, they were always at the back of the line. And you know, the rural guys, the farm boys, they were the ones that were always first in line to get stuff done.
Yeah.
Is it?
I noticed that.
Yeah, bastards. Especially people from Chicago, they're so damn smart.
I was in the 2nd Ranger Battalion, and there's a selection process to get in there. And there's people from all walks of life in the selection process. There was 256 people in my class when we started. 8 of us graduated.
Oh, jeez.
We went on to the Ranger Battalion. When I got there, I noticed like 95% of the people were all grew up on farms or hunters. Yeah. And so.
Ruralists,
yeah. That's just who filtered through the process to the end.
City people, they have to spend too much of their energy to get it done. To exonerate humanity, when people are with people they know, they're more likely to try to help. So there you go. 1967, Brian and Tess researched helping patterns in Los Angeles. They discovered that people were more likely to assist a female driver with a flat tire if they observed someone helping a female driver with a flat tire 1/4 mile up the road. So they were more likely to stop. So then they went to the East Coast, they went to New Jersey, and they observed the donation patterns of Christmas shoppers. Now, one of these little red kettles, you know, the Salvation Army, I don't care about the Salvation Army. Well, I do, because I always put money in their kettle. It's always a bill. When I'm with my grandson, he's the one that puts it in the kettle. I'm trying to teach him to be generous. But I always put something in the kettle, even if it's in Walmart, you know, because there's thousands of people going in and nobody's putting any money in the kettle. I feel kind of sorry for the guy dinging it up. That's why I put the money in there, make him feel better. They found that people were more likely to drop money in a Salvation Army kettle if they had just seen someone else do the same. And of course, I do this all the time, and I watch to see if anybody else does it. They just ignore. You know, it's one of these deals. I don't see the red kettle, and I can't hear the ringing. Is that the way you do it? You look away. Well, at least look them in the eye and say, I ain't going to give you any money today, dude. I don't like Salvation or whatever. But they just can walk around like that. That person doesn't exist. Yes, sir.
I knew a guy who used to be homeless. He used to have a hat. And he told me that he realized that. And they would have one person that acted like a bystander. He would,
sure.
He would go over there and put a dollar in. He was part of the group.
Oh, sure.
And then people would start. Nobody would do it until he did it. So he would do it early on. And it was like, I mean.
Weird. Now, this is kind of interesting because in Gallup, I shop at Walmart. There's always somebody at each entrance with saying, my dog got hit by a truck, and they're in the vet. I never read their signs. But they're always sitting there all cold and freezing. I never give them any money. I'm a cold-hearted bastard.
And as you look at what kind of clothes they're wearing and how they look, how their hair is, and if it doesn't look right, then we don't give them money, but if we can really tell, then sure.
I don't trust those people. I just don't trust them. Panhandlers, just like
I just don't want my money to go to alcohol.
Yeah, well, I don't care what they spend their money on.
You just don't want to give them money.
I don't want to give them money. I'll give the Salvation Army money. I know where that money goes.
Bad experiences when you give people money too. I tried to help somebody get pizza in Chile, and she goes, I don't want pizza because I had a debit card. She goes, I don't want pizza, I want burgers. I'm like, I'm trying to give you a free pizza. And the same thing happens to my sisters in Phoenix and Tucson. Like, one of them was asking like for money, and they're like, I'll go back into Subway. She got him just a basic sandwich, and then he looked at it, and she just walked off, and he threw it back at her because he wanted money.
Oh, my
gosh. I'm like, what the heck is wrong with these people?
What is wrong with you people? Now, here's the weird part. I know you guys just live around here. You go to Phoenix, you go to Gallup, you go to Albuquerque, and somebody's always hitting you up for cash, right? They just give me your pocket change. I don't have any change right now. Two people have hit me up this week for pocket change. And I'm broke. They broke me. And somebody came to my house last night, 9 o'clock at night, asking me for money.
Scary.
I know. Yes, sir.
One of the most successful people I've seen panhandling was in Tucson. This guy held up a sign, and it said, I need a beer. And people were giving him dollars. Like everybody, I noticed it started at the front end. I started laughing that I gave him dollars. I don't like your handler's money, but
he was telling the truth.
Yeah, I appreciated the truth.
Well, here's the weird part. You go across the Mississippi River. Well, you don't even have to go across the Mississippi. Nobody panhandles in Iowa. I mean, it's weird. I mean, down here, I got people coming to my house asking me for cash. In
really?
Iowa, yeah, there's nobody at the stores. There's nobody anyplace asking you for money. It's just strange. I've had 5 people ask me for money this week. It's only Wednesday.
Yeah,
I'm broke. I'm sorry.
I had somebody do that too last year, knock on my door, and said they needed gas money. They told me that they were related to me somehow, and I gave them $5, and I asked my aunt, and she's like, oh, that he'll never see that 5 again. And I thought I was going to give him 20, but all I had was 5. That's a good thing you didn't give him 20.
I'm not related to anybody around here. They can't use that one on me.
They use that. That's the last one. I wasn't related to the person, as it turns out.
Well, neither am I. One factor of modern life is... Oh, I'm sorry. I missed that one. Rushton and Campbell found that British adults were more willing to donate blood if they were approached after observing someone who has consented to donate blood. And, of course, donating blood is very, very important. One factor of modern life is time constraints that we live under. Clever experiment by Darley and Batson in 1973 pitted seminary students and a homeless man. Seminary students, these are people that are going to be priests. They're seminary students. They're going to be priests. They're going to give their life to God. They're not going to take it. Well, they take money to some extent, but it always goes back into the church. These are completely altruistic individuals, theoretically. Okay. So they decided that they were going to pit the seminary students against a homeless man. After listening to the parable of the Good Samaritan, and we talked about the Good Samaritan last time, this was a hated individual. People hated Samaritans because they were of the wrong religious ilk. the Good Samaritan is the only one that helped. All the people that should have helped didn't help, but the Good Samaritan did, even though he was a tainted individual. So they listened to the parable of the Good Samaritan. Two groups of seminary students were confronted with a groaning man on the way to an appointment. For the students, under no time constraints, two-thirds stopped to help. Of the students under time constraints, only 10% stopped to help. These guys are going to become priests. Their job in life is helping people. Yet only 10% of them stopped if they had an appointment. Their appointment was more important than this man's pain.
That's convenient.
Of course. Now here's the horrible part. Two-thirds of them stopped to help when they didn't have any time constraints. That means one-third of them didn't help. So one out of every three people who, and they're supposed to be helpers, but they couldn't take the time out to help a man that was groaning. Now you understand why I attacked religion. Anyway, and these were religious people. These were people that had given their lives to God. And one third of them couldn't stop to help somebody that was in need. Wow, it's irritating. Researchers have often discovered that people who have been induced to lie will feel guilty to the extent that they seek to reclaim their public image. So if I do something bad, I'm more likely to do something good so that I feel good about myself. I've done something bad. I cheated on a social psychology test. Well, you can't cheat because it's just online. You can do anything. You can do it any way you want. You cheated on a math test. So now you're more likely to try to make up for that by doing something good. Even when the guilt is not observed, the subject is more likely to seek retribution by volunteering or redeeming themselves in one way or another. Did I tell you the story of when I cheated in college? Anglo-Saxon. Anglo-Saxon is like German plus English. It's the old language of England. Anglo-Saxon. Then the Normans came in and they mixed French in with it, and that's what we have today. But Anglo-Saxon, it's an old language. And so I was taking a class in Anglo-Saxon. This is my senior year of college. So it was finals time, and we were all in the room, and we were all trying. We had a passage to translate, and so we're all sitting there translating this passage. And the professor leaves, and he says, "Well, just slip your blue books." That's took all of our tests and blue books, and slip them under the door after you're finished. So there's like an hour left of the test, and people started getting up and leaving. And I'm thinking, oh man, I must be the dumbest guy in the world. They're all done, and I'm not doing it. And I'm not finished yet. I'm not even half finished yet. So I'm still working away on this thing like crazy. And finally, there's only two of us left in the room. And the other guy comes up to me and he says, you know everybody's going over to the library to find the translation. And I said, really? He said, yeah, that's what we always do. We always get our translation. That's why we're getting A's in this class. They were all fraternity guys, and I was an independent.
Uh-oh.
Oh, okay. So I did. I went over there and I got a translation. And I copied it. And I felt so bad about it. I felt so bad about it that summer I took my Bryce Anglo-Saxon reader and I translated the whole thing as punishment. I punished myself and I translated everything in that book because I cheated on a test and I felt so bad about it. Got an A-minus on the test. Got an A-minus in the class. But I cheated. It's the only time I cheated when I was in college. And I just wonder how many of those fraternity guys can say, I only cheated once when I was in college. Anyway, that's the one time I cheated. Had all B's and C's when I was in college. Not the smartest guy in the world. Of course, I was married most of the time. You know how wives are. They don't want to let you study. That's the way wives are. They don't want you to study. Negative moods. Researchers have delved into the effect of other negative moods other than guilt and discovered that sometimes it causes less helping behavior and sometimes more. With children, negative moods tend to decrease helping behavior. So if a kid's grouchy, if a third grader is grouchy, they're less likely to try to help somebody. Adults, on the other hand, the more negative their mood, the more likely that they will try to help. Researchers assume that with adult mind, self-gratification and inner rewards are more possible than they are for children. When researchers looked at generosity of elementary, junior high, and high school students, they discovered that as the children aged, they tended to become more socialized and thus more generous. According to, this agrees with Piaget's developmental theory, children are born selfish and become more and more altruistic as they develop the ability to see the world from another's point of view. Now, we just talked about babies crying when other babies cry. Other babies will try to comfort a child that is crying. Even a little 1.5-year-old will come over and pat somebody, trying to make them feel better. So I don't know if Piaget is right or not. I don't know that they are that selfish. We don't become selfish until later on. Researchers have discovered that in most cases when people feel bad, they try to do good deeds to make themselves feel better, except in two circumstances. When you're angry, which I was on Monday, because of Easter, and the other is grief, if you're feeling bad about somebody dying, if you're grieving for one thing or another, or, well, you can grieve about just about anything. You can grieve about a lost relationship. You can be angry about a lost relationship, in which case you're less likely to try to help other people. So this is something that you have to remember. So when you're a counselor and you have lost somebody, your counseling may suffer because of that loss, because you won't feel like helping other people. Yes, sir.
I had a question, because I'm thinking about grief, and I was thinking about, like, some people get busy and start doing things, but
sure.
Is that helping other people, or is that just avoidance? Is that just being busy to avoid dealing with grief?
You know, grief is interesting. I used to work in a Catholic hospital, and they were really good at grief. They're like professional grievers. Catholics. And the reason they're so good at it is because everybody has a job. You know, Aunt Sally has to cook, and Uncle Jim is the guy that has to arrange for all the cars at the funeral. And I mean, everybody's got a job. And so everybody's got something to do. So when they get together, well, and it all depends on what kind of Catholic they are. If they're Irish Catholic, then they hold a wake. And usually, the guys up north of Fort Belknap, they were Irish Catholics. They weren't Irish, but they were Catholics. And their priests had been Irish Catholics. So they would take the casket, they'd take the body, and they put it in the casket, and they'd put it in the gym, and everybody would come and talk about that guy. You know, it's not formal, of course, but he would sit in state for 2 days. So everybody's milling around and talking about this guy. And if he was a veteran, then somebody had to stay with him all night long. So you had, and I always got the 2 o'clock to 5, 6 o'clock shift, because I was, you know, a white guy. And nobody wanted to talk to me anyway. So if he was a veteran, you know, all the veterans would come together and they would divide out the time. And he would always be, somebody would always be with him. Somebody was always supposed to be with him. I was usually the family, but at night it was his buddies from the military.
I find for myself, anyways, with dealing with grief, helping other people really help.
Sure.
Help with that.
Right.
Anger. I and that's true. I think for a lot of veterans, like dealing with grief,
sure,
just getting involved with other veteran groups and people suffering.
Sure. But that's a good point.
As far as anger, for myself, first, I don't know if other people deal with that differently, but for me, it's better to just leave me.
Exactly. Well, that's what they're talking about. And I've noticed you guys don't do grief very well. You really do grief really not very well.
Really?
Oh, my God, no. Everybody else deals with it, but you guys don't even talk about it. You're not even supposed to mention the person's name. And here, you know, we got the Grovant and the Nakota, and, you know, all those Sioux guys up north, they're all just standing around talking about this guy. And you guys won't even mention the dead person's name. So, I mean...
Well, technically, you only have 4 days to grieve. After the fourth day, once they're buried and everything, then that's it. You have to move on.
That's not the way the world works. Getting over...
We gotta deal with it.
Getting over somebody that died takes a lot longer than 4 days. Unfortunately. And you're not allowed to deal with it. And that's just not... I've talked about this in other classes. I'm just attacking you guys.
I've seen this, you mentioned I've seen it in my own family. The people who were more traditional in the family, who understood the process, from a traditional perspective,
right,
were able to go through that grief process in that 4 days. And then even spills over, but you approach it differently after the 4 days. But the people who had no idea, just grieve through the whole thing, and just so grieving, they didn't have any way to
express their grief.
Yeah, through the stages of grief. And
a lot of the problems I see on the reservation, I've got students.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, I'm depressed. My grandfather died 5 years ago, and I've never gotten over that kind of thing. 5 years ago, you're grieving over somebody who died 5 years ago? Yes.
And this is not only with when people pass away, but this is also on our reservation, anyways, relationships. When people break up.
Oh, right. Sure.
They never take the time to grieve and step on their own. And
sure.
Get back to who they were. A lot of times people are just, their serial relationship is like, it's like they jump and they just keep going. Then they got issues upon issues that they don't even know about. Way back.
Don't get me started.
But you're right. I think it's grieving. We don't know how to deal with it.
Yeah, and I've talked to other individuals about this. This is tough. This is really hard. And your traditions don't teach you how to deal with this. Maybe the older people can deal with this, but you know, they've already lost lots of people, so they're already practiced. But if you've got an 18 or 25 year old, and they all of a sudden they lose somebody that is very important to them, they don't know how to deal with it.
I think from a traditional perspective, acceptance is the first step. That's why you accept that this is a natural process of life, that this is going to happen eventually. You
sure.
You're prepared for it already.
Remember,
you have time, you accept
but see, that's the fifth step, not the first step.
So for now, from a traditional perspective, you're supposed to go into already, this is not unnatural, this is not bad, it's a process of life.
But there's also two ways that it can happen too. It can happen naturally, so from old age, or it can happen from suicide, which suicide happens a lot more on the Napo Nation.
Yeah.
So we had to deal with suicide almost, maybe on like a weekly basis, probably.
Yep. I always liken it to, you know, they have to talk about with contagions. I always say contagion, that's okay. But that herd, what is it called? Not the herd mentality, the herd, when you have enough people that are immune.
Right.
To, and then someone comes in, it's able to isolate it.
The herd immunity.
Herd immunity, yeah. And I think the same thing is true with mental health. If you have your community and everybody is grounded and you have enough people who are mentally stable, someone who's grieving can go in there and get help. And
learn how to deal with their
problem. If they go into a group where everybody is dysfunctional,
right,
then nothing gets resolved. It stays, it gets worse.
That's what I'm seeing here.
There's a lot of unresolved trauma.
There's a lot of, not only unresolved trauma, but unresolved grief, and it causes anger. And now we got a bunch of people that don't want to help each other. And that's what I keep seeing.
If you actually think about the Navajo philosophy, perspective, and the teachings, and the natural laws that we have to abide by, death is a subject. Everything's about good things in life. So that's why, you know, we don't think about death or having to grieve or prepare ourselves like that. But then when that happens, it all varies differently with people, because the spirit of that person that deceased, you know, it orbs around, but it's up to us, like we said, acceptance. Well, if we want to take that in deep, or live by the discipline of actually saying, you know, I can't be this way. So basically, you know, at the same time, sometimes that spirit can go into somebody and become close to them and affect them that way. And that's where they have to have a evil way ceremony done, where they get blocked into burn off that spirit.
Well, you know, it's kind of curious that you see people that you love as potential, doing potential damage to you.
Oh yeah, I never got that. I can't visit my sister because my my boyfriend's side is really traditional, and you're like, you can't go up there. It's not going to be her particularly that's going to latch onto you. It's other people that's around there that's going to latch onto you because it's a grave site. You're not supposed to go there in the first place. So yeah. There's a lot of do's and don'ts in Navajo culture, and they all have a different side effect that might happen.
I just want you to do a better job dealing with grief. I don't want to hurt you as much as it seems.
I think it all changed after Christianity came.
Yeah.
I think what you said is true, because that's where I always see is colonization. The effects of it and how we deal with grief, how we accept life, and that whole process was distorted. A lot of people are confused, so you get traditional influence on people who don't understand traditional ways, and they get stuck, they can't, they're not allowed to grieve. And you get people who grieve too much because they don't know where to stop. And, if you go to like a real traditional home where the whole family and everybody and everything's understood, then that grief process, I've seen it carries through and people are able to process and live through. But if you go into, like nowadays, most homes, there's traditional people, there's semi-traditional people, and there's people who are Christian or other religions.
Sure.
And it causes a dysfunction that nobody can get, the family can't get on the same page. Right. And you get people get left out and they get stuck with grief that never gets processed.
I think you can actually see it too, the differences between religions and how they handle grief. You can see it because my family, they're traditional, I guess. So they handle grief way more better than my dad's side, who are Christians, which I don't know why. And they're still grieving over somebody who died almost 20 years ago. So, like...
Same.
Yeah.
Because from a traditional perspective, that person really isn't gone. The physical portion is mature, it's been laid to rest, but the spirit is still around, and there's no need to grieve, I guess. And so if you understand that, you accept that at some point your body's going to go back into the ground. It's just a part of natural, part of life, part of life work, and you're going through all the stages of life. That's from a traditional perspective.
So it has to do with culture, and the more cultural you are, the more traditional you are, potentially the better you can handle grief.
From a traditional perspective, yeah. I'm sure Christians can handle grief and get it right too. But
well, some of them can and some of them can't. Yeah. It really all depends on denomination. Like I said, Catholics are really good at it. There are Protestant religions that they don't even think about it. And then when it happens, they're just all screaming and crying and everybody's, you know, reacting negatively to what happened. And they don't do a very good job. It takes them a long time to get over to grieve because they don't know how to do it. And they don't know how they're supposed to act. A lot of the ways that you act when somebody dies, you act the way that you think you're supposed to act.
Yeah, from a traditional perspective, you're supposed to be, there's stories that go with, like, I use children's stories, but that's the appropriate time to use them, where you talk about the process of life. There's some stories about weaving, the lady who finished her, the kid wouldn't allow her to finish her weaving because she told her child, when I'm done weaving, then it's going to be my time to do it.
Correct.
So for Navajos, traditionally, we used to speak about these things at a young age and address it. And then somewhere, we lost a lot of our understanding of it, and we say, now you're not supposed to talk about it. And they say that about sex. They say that about death. And there's a couple other, I guess they say, taboo subjects. They're not really taboo, they're just people lost the ability to, the stories that go.
You know I'm teaching human sexuality.
I was going to say that. I'm like, that's why it's such a huge controversy.
Just, people lost that, the stories that go with it, but real traditional people know these stories.
Right.
Like if you talk about, like my son asked me about where monsters come from a traditional perspective. So I had to tell him, that was the first discussion we had about sex. I had, when men and the men,
it goes back to the separation of the sexes and things that people did to appease themselves while they were separating. That's where a lot of the monsters came from. So I had to have that discussion with them. So there are ways to talk about it, and it's just people lost that, and then so now it becomes taboo by people who don't really understand it. And then you say it's taboo, you're not supposed to talk about it, so somebody else repeats that and they keep repeating it, and then pretty soon it gets accepted, but it really never was taboo. Mm-hmm. It's just there's an appropriate way to address
and
it.
No, and people don't remember what that way.
A lot of people don't. Yeah. Some people do.
So now it becomes taboo, and all of a sudden I can't talk about sex in class because. only if Wilson's in the room, what can I talk about? So, actually, he came in. You were here when it happened. He came in and started talking about a dream that he had, where five women were attacking him, tearing his clothes off. Wilson told the story.
Because, like, my dad is a diagnostician, so he deals with a lot of people that are dealing with unresolved trauma, grief.
Sure.
And then he deals with a lot of people that deal with, when I go to help them, a lot of people deal with things that come from sexual abuse too.
Sure.
And nobody wants to talk about it.
Exactly.
It gets pushed under the carpet, but it has to be addressed with prayer. But I guess there's almost a shame that gets put on it and like with a taboo too, you're not supposed to talk about it.
What are we going to do?
Alone. But yeah. I've seen real traditional people talk about it real eloquently and describe it. We have very few people who can do that.
Yeah, I was talking to another healer, and he was telling me that most of the problems on the reservation have to do with sexual trauma and grief. The fact that people just don't handle it properly, and therefore it just keeps repeating. They never get over their grief. So we need to figure out a way to do this. You guys need to figure out a way to do this.
Yeah, we
you need to, I mean, you're not going to turn everybody into traditionalists. I mean, it's just not going to happen. So you're going to have to deal with everybody. You're going to have to deal with the traditionalists, the partially traditionalists, the Christians, and the people that have no... You got to deal with everybody. You're going to have to fix everybody. So, I mean, trying to make everybody traditional just isn't going to work. Because you've got people that...
Well, I think
you're not going to turn everybody... You're not going to be able to go back to the 1840s.
Okay? We'll try.
If you're going to talk about, like... I just think that when you're talking about your other class, it's a totally appropriate and beyond appropriate, it's necessary class here at gynecology, that's dealing with psychology. Because you're trying to learn about how people got hurt.
Right.
And then how to help them deal with it.
Exactly.
And if you don't talk about it, you'll never learn it.
You'll never get
it. If it's never taught, you'll never learn it. So we can say it's taboo and we can just keep repeating, doing the same thing over and over and getting the same result. Or we can...
Right.
Be uncomfortable and deal with it.
That's what Wilson was trying to say last year. When he was trying to tell us, or last semester, he was trying to tell us that we needed to teach this. We needed to do something with sexual trauma. Mm. That's what he was trying to say. That's what I interpreted anyway. But of course, one of my colleagues just went for listening.
So when you first came out here, what did you expect?
Well, I had already worked up north. With natives up north,
like so out here,
you guys are like the polar opposites of the people up north.
Did you think it was gonna be the same?
Yeah, I figured. You know, I'd run into the Blackfeet. You know, I'd been dealing with the Blackfeet and the Crow and the Sioux and the Gros Ventre and the Salish Kootenai. Taught at Salish Kootenai College. You know, the Turtle Mountain people. Like, you know, those rich Block Crees.
So we're just a mess, right?
You're just different. I mean, you're totally different, and they're more embracing. They embrace each other.
How do they deal with the grief and anger up there?
Well, I just told you they're primarily Catholic, so
Okay. Yeah.
So they've celebrated people's lives, and then they buried them, and then they felt good about not about the fact that they're dead, but they felt good about the fact that they had been alive. So they celebrated their lives. They remembered all the good things about this person. That's
like
how
that,
they dealt with the death.
Like the Paiute tribe, because I grew up in Utah, and they have like a sing all night for the person that passed away, and the family has a year to where their family gathers all the person that passed away, all of their belongings, And during the 1 year anniversary of their death, they have a big time where they celebrate their life and then they burn all of their belongings, and that's it.
The people up north, they give their stuff away. They'll give their cars away, they'll give their horses away, they give their blankets away, and all this has to take place within a year. And after a year, then they, of course, they believe in powwows, so after a year, they dance you back into the circle. You're not allowed to grieve for longer than a year. So at a select powwow, close to the anniversary of the death of that individual, they will dance you back into the circle. This, you know, and of course, powwows always take place in circles. So they're telling you that you can't grieve anymore, which almost always works, like 90% of the time it works. Sometimes it doesn't, but I mean, normally it does. But that's just the way they deal with it. And they don't seem to suffer nearly as much as you guys.
A big problem with grief too, accepting death on the Navajo Reservation, comes from the loss of culture, because a part of that is when, the reason that it's the 4 days that you're allowed to grieve is we believe during that time that person is being purified, their spirit is being purified by water, air, and fire, these different elements, and it gets purified, and then they go back to the holy people. So during that time, you can cry for them and grieve for them, but after the 4 days, when their spirit goes back to be the holy people, at that point, how you're supposed to address them is with white corn and oil. Before the sun comes up, you're supposed to talk to them. So that's supposed to help you complete your grief. You're supposed to start talking to them as part of the whole thing. But nobody does it. Praying early in the morning is one in a thousand now. It's very, very rare. I mean, they'll do it once in a while if it's at a ceremony, but not many people do it in the morning on a daily basis like they used to. And so they lost that connection. And then you're told you're not supposed to cry after that. It's not that you're not supposed to cry, because you can cry in prayer. It's just that you're not supposed to wish that they were still here alive. You're supposed to celebrate that they're back with their ancestors. And so there's like a process, and it's kind of like crying and grieving is considered looking, trying to go backwards. It's a little unnatural. But it's just because people don't know how to look forward to the East anymore.
What you're going to find out as you become counselors and you work here on the reservation is this is a problem, and you're going to have to deal with it.
I already know what I want to
do. Okay. I'm glad. You're not going to proselytize and turn everybody into a Catholic priest, right? Okay.
Because it's like, for now, I think some people are astonished or shocked when you can talk to your grandparents anytime you want. You just take out your cutadine and you start praying. You're addressing your folks that are already gone. They don't understand that, and I think it's because they've been so culturally, they don't understand that their ancestors, they want to be back with their ancestors. They're split between the traditional story of your spirit wanting to be with the ancestors and heaven. You don't know where. And you'll see it all the time. I hope he's in heaven.
Well, one of the things about the people up north, they feel that their grandparents are protecting them. So they're around them all the time.
Yeah, that's a traditional concept.
Yeah. So you can talk to them, and you can pray to them, and anytime you're at a ceremony, you always face the four cardinal directions, and you're talking to your grandfathers, and each of you are talking to a different person, of course, because you're talking to your grandfathers, which doesn't include me, of course, because I'm not one of those. I'm a Belagani, I guess, so I can't talk to my But I'm not Christian either, so I'm kind of SOL. Write that down, SOL. They also found that when people feel good, they tend to do good deeds. So you do good deeds when you're happy, and you do good deeds when you're unhappy, but not when you're grieving or when you're angry. I hope I didn't offend anybody with talking about grief. The black clothes drive me crazy. Especially at night in Chinle, when everybody's walking around in black clothes. You can't see anything. Unless they've got, something on their shoes that shine up. Looking at personality traits, researchers have discovered that there are individual differences in helpfulness and have shown that these differences persist over time. There are a network of traits that predispose a person toward helpfulness. those high-end emotionality, empathy, and self-efficacy. So you have to feel good about yourself before you can help somebody else. And if you don't feel good about yourself, you're not going to help anybody else. High monitoring people are helpful if they think helpfulness will be socially rewarding. These are people that are always trying to make an impression on other individuals. They will help as long as they think that other people will see it. And they will tell you, geez, I just told you guys about the people that came to my house, didn't I? I guess I must be high monitoring. I didn't give him any money last night. I'm broke. And the ATM is gone.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, my goodness. What am I going to do for money? Correlation. Is there another one anywhere close? Do I have to go all the way to Chinle to get
Window Rock?
Window Rock?
Chinle. The store will give you like $20, $25 cash back. Just keep going in. Buying a soda.
Correlational studies looking at 172 studies have shown that when faced with situations where strangers need help, that is potentially dangerous, men are more likely to help than females. In a safer situation, however, women are slightly more likely to help than men. Eagerly and Crowley speculated that over the long term, rather than the short term of most experiments, women would be seen as more helpful than men. So women are more altruistic than men, but just a little bit. While there are instances of religious leaders making some fairly significant sacrifices, studies show that intrinsically religious people are only slightly more likely to help in cases of minor emergencies and spontaneous helping acts. This really irritates me because they keep asking you for money, religious people. You need to give to this mission. You need to give to that mission. You need to give to the church. You're supposed to tithe.
Isn't that what's going on with Notre Dame right now?
You mean the church in Paris?
They're trying to
rebuild.
They received $1 billion in donations to rebuild it, but everyone else is like, what about the homeless? What about veterans? What about the earth? And they're like, the church? Like, I mean, I guess. I don't know. It's
so you don't want to build the church? You want to help people? What the hell's wrong with you?
That's the whole point of the church. I'm supposed to help people.
You know, actually, what you just brought up goes, it proves what your other side was talking about. Like if someone helps, then other people will start helping.
Yeah.
Because the other churches in the South, they had a police go, five black churches that were burned down.
And one church was burned.
Everybody
was shocked. That's when they started doing stuff. They waited until the white church was burned.
And they said that donations increased after Notre Dame caught fire.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Sure. I think it's kind of stupid. It's sad. I saw one video where somebody took a. There's a lot of people who used to go to the church, I guess. I don't even know if they actually went. But they were singing and. I guess it was like a prayer for the church. It was really sad, and I'm like, okay, I'm looking at it a little differently, and people were like calling Native Americans like assholes because they're like, who cares? Yeah, people were starting to call Native Americans like names and stuff because we didn't care that it burned down because it's a church. And
then, you mean the Notre Dame?
Like any religious group, any church person, because Native Americans were like saying, who cares that it burned down? And they were starting to call us like, assholes and stuff. Jeez. And people were like,
you do understand that most Native Americans do go to church and most of them are Christians of one ilk or another.
I mean yeah, but they're saying like the art, the culture, so much was lost, and people were like, what?
Who cares?
And we're like, that same thing happened to us, but nobody said anything. And then all of a sudden,
well, you didn't
happened.
Have an edifice. You needed a building. And if you had a building, then everybody would go, look, that building's missing. Buildings are more important than people. Everybody knows
but
that.
But the land, they're saying art, culture, that's exactly what was lost over here and everywhere else that was taken over by those kind of people, the church people.
You do understand that in Sri Lanka, they blew up, 6 churches?
Oh, my
God. And 6 hotels, and they killed 300 and some people. It was the ISIS that did it. Anyway, they targeted churches on Easter Sunday. When everybody was there, theoretically.
I'm still not going to feel that bad about it.
So are we going to rebuild the churches in Sri Lanka, or
rebuild the church, rebuild Notre Dame. Notre Dame is a is an iconic building. It's been around for since the 13th century. I'm not saying don't rebuild it or do rebuild it. What I'm saying is it's an iconic building.
Yeah.
And of course, it didn't have anything to do with terrorist attacks, probably.
How did it break down?
They were remodeling it, and evidently something, they were welding something up in the roof, and the roof is
it was an accident, then they're making it sound like somebody did it on purpose. No. What happened to forgiveness and stuff?
Yeah, that was the first reaction, was everybody thought it was Muslims. Yeah. There's a lot of Muslim hate toward it that was going around.
And then ISIS actually did blow up the all those churches in Sri Lanka.
But it's so sad. They actually thought somebody was going to burn down the church, and then it wasn't.
But five people did burn, or that one guy did burn down those five churches. It was a white supremacist. Burned down all those black churches. The logic is just escapes me. I have no idea why that works.
And it's getting so frustrating.
And then some white supremacist blew up the white church. I don't know, as payback or.
But the Sacred Mountain that's in Flagstaff, they put poop water on it. And Navajos and other tribes, they try to say, like, it's technically, like, you know, say it's a church, but it's, like, for us, right? That's how they're trying to explain it to them.
Where did they put it?
They made snow out of sewer water, and they're putting it on the Sacred Mountain for a ski resort.
Oh,
so they're saying, like, oh, but it's okay because it's technically, like, still not your land.
What a smell.
So,
oh, God.
They don't care.
And it's also,
no one cares.
And then they're calling us assholes because they don't care about Notre Dame.
I don't blame them. I don't care about Notre Dame.
It's hypocrisy.
I've been there. It is a big, big building. It was. It's not so big anymore. As far as donations are concerned, however, 24% of the population makes 48% of the charitable donations. So we've got a small percentage doing most of the work. Looking at 35 studies that compared help given to men and help given to women, men were more likely to offer help to women than to men. Women offered help equally to both genders. Women are more likely to be offered help than men, and single people are more likely to be offered help than two or more people. Yeah, if you notice people picking people up, they always pick up singles, but they would pick up two or three people. I guess they feel it's more dangerous. Men are more likely to offer help to attractive women over unattractive women. Women tend to seek help more than men do, and so that's just the way it works. People are not only more likely to like people who are similar to them, but they are more likely to help people who are similar to them. Less than 50% of the people dressed differently made change for an individual as compared to two-thirds who were dressed similarly. So if you were dressed in board shorts and a t-shirt, you're more likely to help somebody who's dressed in board shorts and a t-shirt. When race is a factor, people will help unless the bystander effect is enforced. If there's too many people around, they will help. I'm sorry. I'm white. I don't know if you guys noticed that I'm white. So sometimes when I'm walking down the street, I make eye contact with people. And if it's somebody that's panhandling, they'll come up to me because I've made eye contact.
You haven't learned not to.
Exactly. I haven't learned not to. So the interesting thing is, well, you guys probably don't understand, but black people don't look in black people's faces very much. They don't see them. They try to pretend they don't exist. So if you're a white person who makes eye contact with a black person, that person will say hello, or they will try to borrow money from you or whatever. But so this has happened to me over and over again. I usually, if I'm in an airport someplace, the white panhandlers leave me alone, but the black panhandlers, they think I'm going to give them money because I make eye contact with them.
Because
I'm white? The white people don't.
Well, like, 4 years ago, like, I thought, oh, white people were
nice.
They were nice.
Really? They're not? No, there's only, like, six of us.
I thought white people were nice. They're like, oh, they'll give me money.
They'll give me money.
Yeah.
Anyway, so, which is kind of interesting, because in the South, white people will not make eye contact with black people. I used to teach at Mississippi University for Women in Columbus, Mississippi, and I'd walk down the street, and I'd be saying hello to everybody, because I'm making eye contact with not only black people, but with white, not only with white people, but black people as well. If I were with somebody who was from Mississippi, who was white, they wouldn't look at the black people. They'd look away. It's like they didn't want to see them, like they were invisible people.
Is that like that here? Because I know that for Navajos, they don't like making eye contact a lot. They usually like try and look away because I think it's rude. I'm not really sure. I forgot what the whole reason was, but we don't like to make eye contact, I think. So, do you notice that here?
No? Yeah. Yeah, yeah, I'll walk down the side. Well, but a lot of times it has to do with the fact they've got something in their ears or they're looking at their telephone. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm. I say hello to everybody. I try to anyway. But half the time they don't pay attention.
You know what eye contact phenomena I want to understand? Is when you're passing somebody, you always got to feel the need to look over, and then when the other person does the same thing, you look away. I don't understand why.
That awkward moment.
when you're trying to decide whether to make eye contact. As interesting as that is. Researchers have found that any technique that personalizes bystanders increases the willingness to help. Personal requests, eye contact, and this is what I was just talking about as far as people asking me for money. I say hi to everybody, so it's only panhandlers that ask me for money.
Do you think it's because eye contact is considered personal?
Yeah, it means that I want to make contact with you. If you're in a city, like you said, I haven't learned not to make eye contact. When I'm in Iowa, I make eye contact with everybody. No big deal.
It's weird. Like, for now, we're talking, or when we're not talking, you're teaching. If I'm looking at you, it's not considered inappropriate for me to be looking at you.
But if I'm,
but if I was looking at her just through the whole class, she'd probably get a little creeped out. I think it was a little inappropriate. Like, why are you staring at me? I think eye contact is considered personal, maybe.
Sure. Yeah, it means I want to be your friend, or I want to make contact. I like to think of it as I want to be your friend.
I think the reason why now I'm able to make eye contact is because of respect.
Oh.
You know, a lot of intimidate anybody or make anybody think a certain way.
Okay. Yeah. So if you respect me, you don't make eye contact with me?
But a stranger, yeah, if you're just looking to meet somebody, you don't want to offend them.
Yeah, especially if that's somebody you met, also you can.
See, that's the opposite.
Until you made that probably connection, huh? Then it's appropriate to.
Unless you make that connection within the relationship.
So where do elders fit in this whole thing? Are you supposed to show respect to elders so you can never make eye contact with them?
I don't know, that's a good question.
It's not like just looking at the floor, just like occasionally, but don't glare at them, I think.
Yeah, I think staring is the rude, is considered rude.
Well, try and look at a Navajo elder for the first time an elder you've never met before. See them and just kind of look at them or smile at them and see what they do. They'll probably give you 1 or 2 seconds of their attention before they turn away.
You know what? I notice now, like when you're talking to someone, like someone who's more older, they stand like this. They never stand directly, so they just stand next to you and they just look out like this. Yeah. That's what I've noticed so far.
Wow. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
I don't know if that has changed with colonization. I don't know. That's really interesting. It's an interesting question.
That's actually, like I said, that's just the way it's always been. Because I've heard stories of like how our ancestors were like that. They never like sat there and looked up in the eyes and just smiled or anything like that.
I'm wondering how you make contact with each other. It sounds so.
Well, it was different a long time ago too. Like, we even had our original form of government, they didn't speak. They used hand signals.
hand gestures to communicate. They need to speak to each other, yeah.
One of the main things when it comes to Navajo today is transparency, spiritual transparency. We have that connection with one another, our minds or spirit like that. Hmm. Like you said, you don't even have to talk to people. You can already sense what they're feeling.
I think there's an appropriate time to look and stare and keep eye contact, but it's definitely not when you haven't made the introduction yet.
Okay.
So I think that's what it is.
Well, we're both military, so we can make all the eye contact we want. Are you eyeballing me?
No, that's what I'm just thinking about. I got called into my captain's office. I got accused of something. I was looking at it. I was in a position of tension, looking straight ahead, and he's sitting down over here. And I got accused of something, and I looked at him, and I don't know what the F was on my face, but that's what he said. He's like, "Why are you eyeballing me?
Yeah, why are you?"
And I had to look away. But it's considered rude too in the military.
Yeah. Well, kind of. Kind of.
In a formal setting, it's considered rude. In an informal setting.
It's well, you're not supposed to be looking at anybody when you're standing at attention. Okay, we already talked about donating blood. People obviously care about their public image, especially individuals high in self-monitoring. The door in the face technique is a strategy for getting people to help by making a large request that they will no doubt refuse and then accepting a smaller, more reasonable request. Using the door in the face technique, researchers at Arizona State were able to double their donations. In other words, what they do is they ask you for $1,000. Well, if you can't give $1,000, how about $500? If you can't give $500, how about
compromise?
$50? And you're going, well, I didn't give them $1,000, I didn't give them $500, I'll give them $50. They're really thinking, well, geez, I hope they give us $5. But you gave them they gave you 10 times as much. Researchers and historians have discovered that people tend to create a circle of inclusion about them of the people that they attribute similar moral values and rules. And this is known as moral inclusion. In other words, you assume that other individuals have the same morals that you have. Moral exclusion, on the other hand, are those all those people outside the sphere of people seen as similar enough to be included. And this is, of course, is the way, and this is exactly what we're talking about right now. We were talking about moral inclusion and moral exclusion. I'm white, so am I inclusive or am I exclusive? Is my morality the same as yours? And the assumption is that if I'm different, if you're different from me, then you don't have the same morality that I have. And this is something that has been especially done with African Americans. African American males, what are they like? We stereotype them. And because we stereotype them, it is a moral exclusion. We assume that they are different from us. And that's where the prejudice comes in. And this is one of the reasons that we keep blowing them away. We keep shooting them in the streets because of the moral exclusion. The reason that they don't shoot unarmed white people in the streets is because of moral inclusion. They assume they have the same ideas. And this is really kind of a serious situation. It has to do with moral inclusion and exclusion. There you go. We need to stop right here. Since Denise is here, we'll stop.